Welcome to the Lakeshore Records podcast. Today I had the enormous pleasure of speaking with the great Matt Sweeney, an incredible guitarist, songwriter, and all-around badass who you've heard on many iconic records. Johnny Cash, Adele, Run the Jewels, you name it. We discussed Matt's collaborative process with the Rockstar Games music team and Dave Ferguson on their number one charting soundtrack to Red Dead Redemption 2, the house building EP, Thelonious Monk's Rules for Life, self-expression as an overrated endeavor, sessions with the incomparable Rick Rubin, Appalachian music as a transcendent art form, Adele's love of 70s Dion, playing on Johnny Cash's American 5 and 6 albums, finger-picking techniques versus guitar center licks, the wisdom of John Prine and Bill Withers, Matt's longtime collaborator Will Oldham, and much, much more. The Red Dead Redemption 2 house-building EP is out now worldwide via Lakeshore Records. I hope you enjoy my conversation with Matt Sweeney as much as I did.
Welcome, Matt.
Hi.
What's up? How you doing, man?
I think I'm okay.
Hey, man, congratulations. You got a number one soundtrack.
We did? Oh, right, we did. That's cool. That's neat.
That's awesome.
Yeah,
I guess
that's true, you know? I mean, yeah. Not many people could say a lot of things, but yeah, that's really, that's exciting. That's cool. Yeah.
Yeah, well, before we get into Red Dead and all that, I would love to just start from the beginning, man. Just like, you can just tell me a little bit about like where you grew up, what got you into music, or what got music into you. I'd love to know anything you can give us there.
I grew up on the East Coast. I was born in 1969 in New York City. My parents moved to the suburbs of New Jersey so my dad could teach could continue teaching at Seton Hall University. So I grew up around a lot of music. Neither of my parents liked rock music, but my mom liked whatever was on the radio, and she could sing really well and could harmonize to anything. My father was a bagpiper and a Chaucer scholar and really into history. I heard the Monkees when I was 5 and decided that I should play music, which was an idiotic decision that I still am making good on, I suppose. I got into, I started playing bass guitar because my dad bought me a bass because he thought that too many people played guitar because somebody told him that. When I was like 12, and I started playing heavy metal covers, and then I got into hardcore music and started playing guitar. And then by the time I was 17 or 18, I had I was playing shows and was able to like go out and play shows and stuff. And that was kind of like noisy rock music. And then, I quit music, then started playing music again. I quit music because my first band broke up and I realized that I was a ding dong and should never do music. So then I started playing music again right away. Because I'm a ding dong. And then, and by that point I moved to New York, played in a noise band, started another noisy band that started writing songs. That band was called Chavez. Made records for Matador Records with Chavez. That band stopped doing stuff. And then I started playing a lot of music with Will Oldham, which I continue to do to this day. We do a thing called Super Wolf. We have a record coming out. I played music with Will, did some other musical projects, and somehow I really don't know. I have no fucking idea how I got here, dude. I don't know what I'm doing.
Well, you know, one thing you know how to do is play the guitar, right?
So the Red Dead thing was, I made a record called Super Wolf. Rick Rubin really liked that record. He asked me to play on Johnny Cash recordings, and Johnny Cash recorded a bunch of songs with this guy, Dave Ferguson, right before Johnny Cash died. And the understanding, and Dave Ferguson was his engineer was Johnny Cash's engineer and kind of like best friend. Johnny Cash and Dave Ferguson had worked with Rick Rubin before on the records that Rick had made for Johnny. But he made a bunch of recordings before he died. I got called by Rick to record, to do overdubs on these recordings with, and I met Ferg, who I ended up doing this house building music with, in that context, I showed up again, having no fucking idea what I was doing, to Rick Rubin's studio, and Ferg was there, and it became pretty, Ferg was there and Tom Petty's band was there, and we were just tracking live acoustic music to Johnny Cash's voice. And that's how I learned, that's how I met Ferg. That's sort of how I, that whole experience, I'd never worked on a thing like that, certainly, and certainly nothing that terrifying as far as being in, having to play live acoustic music to Johnny Cash's voice. was a little bit nerve wracking. But I made, in that process, I immediately made friends with Dave Ferguson, because it's sort of clear, it was very clear that like Rick was the producer, but Dave Ferguson was Johnny Cash's best friend, who had to like record this music when his friend was dying, and he was really close to it, you know. And just working right away, I was like, oh my God, this guy Fergie is amazing, you know. And also I heard Fergie sing kind of early on when we were working on the Johnny Cash stuff, and also his voice really blew my mind. So after that, we ended up that experience was really, really great. That recording experience was great. And Fergie and I became kind of unlikely but very tight friends right away. And we started working on projects, on kind of Rick Rubin projects out in LA. And then Fergie invited me to go to Nashville. But this is like, by this point, it's like 2006 or seven that I first went to Nashville to work with Ferg. And that was, I'm a New York guy, but going to Nashville was a huge, you know, kind of honor, and also kind of terrifying, because Ferg was like, he's the guy in Nashville. His community isn't the pop country community. It's the bluegrass community. It's basically Johnny, it's the best bluegrass players. And it's also basically what's left of Johnny Cash's circle, to a certain degree, the circle of friends that he liked to play music with, to be clear. So I started going down to Nashville and bringing other people in, people like myself who don't have access to this incredible resource that Dave Ferguson has, which is musicians and with an intimate knowledge of Appalachian music and of basically country music, but meaning folk music, hillbilly music, which is what Ferg calls it. So you know, like I just stepped in this golden pile of awesome when I met Ferg, and because my mind is shot, but about 4 years ago, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, at my local bar in New York, Max Fish, Tony from Rockstar Games came up to me and said, and asked if I'd be interested in working on music for Red Dead Redemption 2. And I said, sure. And then I was so drunk, I kind of forgot about the conversation. And then got a conversation. Then Tony, I guess I got an email or something saying, hey, you know, I was like, oh, right. Oh, okay, cool. So met with them, and Tony and Yvonne are, you know, I'm lucky. I've gotten to work with lots of different people. And I'm really not being like nice by saying that I really, really enjoy working with Tony and Yvonne, who are the music guys at Rockstar Games. I guess I'll get into that later, but from the first meeting that I had with them, they were so crystal clear on what they needed. And they're also so crystal clear on what they didn't know. and it's a really good mixture of the two. So what they told me was, you know, they told me that the soundtrack was, you know, largely done or had a shape, and that Woody Jackson had, you know, done this incredible job, but there's just all of this other, there are all these other missions, and these missions that were kind of like, I think they're just honest. They're like, these aren't the important missions. These are the, you know, these are, you know, I was like, oh, I understand video games and stuff, and for sure. And I weirdly have a background with Rockstar Games, because I helped brand that company for my day job in the 90s. But anyway, so like I knew what the game was about. But what they told me was, you know, that, you know, I said, well, what is it, still like a Morricone vibe? You know, like what kind of music are you looking for? And they said, well, we really like this music that you've made. And they talked about, like, I don't know what they talked about. Maybe they talked about Super Wolf, or I'm not sure what, I guess they must have talked about that, which is this record, which is a record that I made that has a lot of finger picking on it. So going back to Tony and Yvonne being so good at describing what they needed, you know, they were able to go down to Nashville, get in a room full of like these incredible hillbilly players and tell them, I mean, you know, kind of tell them what to do, because I was learning also as we were going, you know, as we were going along. And essentially what the way that the process would work for Red Dead was they would show the scene. They would tell us we worked with Tony and Yvonne, but a lot with Tony. Tony would show us the scene, would tell us the characters, and, you know, sort of set it up. And then I'd stare at him and be like, okay. And then I'd come up with basically a two part thing, like the, here's, you know, like here's the A riff, you know, and then I'd play him a bunch of stuff and he'd be like, nah, 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 nah. Ooh, that's good. You know what I mean? And he's like, okay, run with that. And then I come up with a B part. And it was kind of all a lot of it was on the fly. I mean, of course, I came in with like, I don't know what, 20 pieces, you know, that were sort of this way. But a lot of times, like when you're in a room with somebody, you just kind of go, you know? And because what was interesting, what the assignment for all these pieces was that it had to be like emotional, but at the same time, it couldn't be overbearing, you know? Mm-hmm. You know, and we're not relying on pads, you know, or like, you know, it's like real playing, you know, it's actual parts, you know what I mean? So it was actually, I mean, I was kind of impressed that they came to me, because actually this is sort of something that I think I'm okay at, like is sort of being able to get a mood going just with a minimal amount of picks playing and stuff. And also I play, I'm a member of a group called Endless Boogie, and we do like 30 minute songs with no chord changes, but that seriously, it's called Endless Boogie. So I was like, okay, you know, like I was like, I definitely understand the idea of music that goes on forever and isn't boring and isn't atmospheric or droney, or, you know what I mean? Like there's a, I was emotionally, I understood what they were going for, you know, as far as just kind of creating a mood that has movement, but that isn't overbearing, you know, but still has tons of feeling and stuff. So that was, I think that's kind of the best way to describe almost what every situation had. Like that was kind of the ask, you know, was to come up with distinctive yet non-overbearing music, you know.
And as you created all these tracks, you know, you're writing lyrics too, right? I mean, these are songs.
Well, no, we're not writing lyrics, because the only song that happened was the house building thing, which actually I had nothing to do with, which was like, so meanwhile, they have all these songs, right? And which is like, it's kind of a separate thing, which is like, so they have the soundtrack that we're working on, but also there was this understanding that there was this need for songs and mm-hmm. and that they were kind of open. So I remember I submitted one just for the fuck of it, and they're like, oh, that's kind of good, and that kind of ended up going nowhere. But then the other one was like, I remember it came up, they're like, oh, we have this house building
yeah.
thing, you know, and who do you think should write it? We don't know. And then I think that Ferg was just like, why not this, you know? And I think Ferg, he just threw down a demo of the song, sent it to them. They're like, oh, you know, we kind of like this. Well, and if I'm not mistaken, it was kind of like, all right, this is in the ballpark. It may have been a placeholder thing. You know what I mean? That song, the house building. And then I remember then going back and forth with Tony, like they were like, well, maybe it should be like this, or maybe we should get somebody else, or could we do that? And I was like, well, even the firm version is really good. They're like, yeah, we know it's really good. You know, just nobody's heard it yet, so we don't know how it's going to play or whatever, you know? But it really was like, it was very like not a big thing, you know, like it was one of these kind of classic things where, you know, they were like, yeah, you know what? Yeah, we're just going to stick with Ferg's, you know, like, you know, that was kind of like what they were like, you know, it's good. And everybody seems to like it. Okay. So like, let's just leave it alone and see what happens, you know?
Well, I have to say, I have a 2-year-old and a 5-year-old, and I've played the EP, and they dig it.
Great. You know, it's fun. Well, that song that Ferg wrote is like it's such a classic. Like, you know, I mean, it's, and also I can see how kids would love it, you know. Yeah. And you know, it's funny, as Ferg is like the gnarliest dude ever. He's like this cigarettes, but he has this thing, you know, he's one of my best friends, but like, I'm not really like a kid's guy. I mean, I think kids are awesome, but I've never seen children flock to a scarier individual. it's like, and I'm not kidding. It's like children and dogs with Ferg, they go crazy. They just like, they just see him. And also he's got this rumble. I mean, it has to do with this rumbly voice that he has. I don't know what the fuck it is, but like, it's really, I'm glad your kids did. Cause I remember when I heard it, I was like, yep, that's like, that's some classic version. This is like, this song sounds like it's been around for a million years. It's utterly lovable. It's utterly approachable. It's really, it has this weird heart to it. That's like, kind of, I can't put into words, you know, it's just got this real, like, wow, it sounds like he really means it, you know, and there's nothing more to say.
I'm a musician as well. I would say the same of your playing and a lot of your music. I was going to ask you about that. Like, how, you know, there are people who are really great players who have really high technical ability and often want to demonstrate that. And what I notice from your stuff is like, you're not being like, look at me, you're not showing off. Like, you understand the power of pocket and all of that. And I'd love to know how you came. That's a sort of wisdom that's tough to sort of, you know, you don't find that often.
That's a well said question. Because you know, that's really the question of music is like, do you want to be demonstrative? I mean, are you, when you're playing music, are you trying to be demonstrative? And by demonstrative, I mean, which is to say, are you trying to demonstrate how fucking good you are and what you know, or are you trying to connect on a feeling level? You know what I mean? Which takes a great deal of technique and stuff, but it's certainly, you want to like not, you don't want to tell, you want to show, you know what I mean? In a way, like, demonstrative, by being demonstrative, you're telling, you're telling somebody, hey, look at me playing guitar, this is the thing, you know, and by showing, you just do it, you know what I mean? And it, you assume that the listener is intelligent enough to be listening, you know, and is sensitive enough to not need to be, you know, hammered, you know,
has that always been something that you've
done? No, hell no. I mean, you know, I have like no taste at all. You know, I'm totally, you know, like tasteless and crass and, you know, no restraint whatsoever. You have to learn it. You know, like, I mean, my first band had like 8 million parts to their songs, you know, like, you know, a zillion. And then it's just a matter of, you know, you get better at it. But I feel like it is hard to have restraints, you know, like, especially when you're younger, I think you just want to say and feel a million things. You want to get it all out, you know? So I think that I didn't approach anything with anything that you could call restraint until I was I've been playing for like probably 10 years before it occurred to me that it could be cool to like, to chill a little bit. Sure. But I also found that I'm a guitar player primarily. And finger picking slowed me the hell down. You know what I mean? Like, because, and that's kind of what I do. And that's like something that I came to myself, and that's really why I think that's when I started getting paid. You know, it's just like, I could do this thing that's not fancy, but sounds different than a standard guitar. You know what I mean? Like, which is basically, you know, you could just play a simple, you could play two things at once, and they could be two really, really simple things at once, but it's people like to hear that, you know what I mean? Like it creates a feeling, just one thing, you get one color against another color, you know what I mean? Which is like what happens if you're picking, you know?
How did you learn? I'm a composer, but mostly piano. I started on piano. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. I've self-taught guitar, but like, and I can finger pick, but like using my ear, right? I never actually took a guitar lesson. So I'm just curious, how did you master that? Did you have specific?
I had a friend show me a pattern. This was, you know, like YouTube changes everything. I don't know if you've noticed this, but like if you could see somebody do something, God, it makes such a difference, you know? And I grew up going to shows and seeing a lot of stuff. So generally everything that I did learn was from just being next to somebody and watching them do it, you know? So I grew up in New Jersey. There are a lot of heavy metal players around. So I was able to kind of very quickly get quote unquote chops, which were kind of, which was kind of cool, you know, like, you know what I mean? Like when you're growing up, you pick it up and you can just play really fast all of a sudden, but you know, sure. you don't have any, you don't know what you're doing really, but you physically can do that. And so in my early 20s, my friends who were really intense about music had gotten into old time music and hillbilly music and bluegrass. And I went to this festival in Charlotte, Michigan. And that's the first time and my friend Sam Dillon had learned how to play some Mississippi John Hurt finger picking patterns. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, what the fuck? You know, I was just obsessed. I would just watch him do it. I was like, how are you doing that? You know, like it drove me crazy. And so he showed me how to do that. Or he showed me what to do rather. And then I realized, shit, okay, now I know what I have to do. Now it's just a matter of doing it, which is, you know, it's basically like juggling, you know, or it's like playing piano. It's just, you're just doing two things at the same time that naturally you can't do, you know, but the end result, once you start doing it, it sounds very, very natural. So you just have to sort of sit in your sweatpants in discomfort and just suck so hard to get there, you know. Sure. And I think that a lot of people who approach finger picking, say a lot of guitarists, they often have learned how to play rock guitar. So like, mm-hmm. why do you want to fucking finger pick? You know, it just seems like, it's like, why do I want to be that vulnerable and like basically have to relearn everything? You know, like I do understand why people don't even bother, because like, or I could just still keep on going wow and sound cool, you know. But for me, I just, like, I loved John Fahey, I loved Nick Drake, I loved all this stuff. And when I saw that my friend could do it, and I saw that there was actually a way to do it, I realized that there wasn't any excuses anymore. I just had to fucking figure it out and do it. So I was, I think 26, 27, you know, when I started doing that, which would be about 10 years after being, you know, a little longer than that. I guess I got serious about playing when I was like 14 or something like that. So by the time, it's only 10 years later, there I am, just like picking up an acoustic guitar. Actually, I would just pick on an electric guitar too. It really doesn't matter. But it was really humiliating. But you just do it, you know? So I did it from learning from a friend, and also like watching, and really just watching like RL, seeing RL Burnside play a lot kind of had an effect on me, just cause because that dude would just sit there and all the sound would be coming out of his guitar and he'd barely be moving. You know, mm-hmm. literally like nothing would be moving and this big sound. So that's when I realized, I was like, okay, this is just a trick. It's a fucking trick. And I'm going to learn how to do this trick, you know? And it's like a magic trick. And as much as music is, you know, is so much like close up magic, in that most of the people who practice it are alcoholics. Just kidding. Mm-hmm. Not really. But I was gonna say it's just like close to magic, because you have to learn how to do this thing and act like you didn't learn how to do anything. You know what I mean? Like the whole you do this thing to make it seem like you didn't do anything, and all of a sudden everybody's crying or everybody's going, oh my god, you know, and you know, you go, phew, and here's the thing, and then with music you go blah, and on, you're singing beautifully, you know, like, and the audience is just going to take it. They don't care how you came to it. They don't care how much you practice. They would like to assume that it just came out of your mouth, and that's great, and that's what you want to, or it just came out of your hands, and that's what you want to do, is give this sense of sort of wonder and ease in the viewer. And what that takes is like the opposite of wonder and the opposite of ease. You know, like,
sure.
So like, you know, but in the case of like finger picking with guitar, I had this clear thing where I was like, wow, that's really fucking hard. But if I could do that, it can like lead to stuff. And it's weird, because I was never career minded so much as I just always wanted to play music and be, you know, around music and just be lost in music as much as possible, you know? And there was something about picking where I just fucking knew, like, it's like, if I get this down, it's like, it's a self-contained skill that is really pretty awesome. And if I do this, it's going to get me out of the rock thing. It's just going to get me somewhere interesting. I was convinced of that, and I was fucking right. I gotta say,
you were right, you know. Good call. Thank you.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this. This is a little bit of an esoteric question, but what the fuck is it about an acoustic guitar and specifically finger picking that makes you immediately feel like, obviously we're conditioned to think of, you know, Appalachia and
right, folk, right.
But still there's something, feels like there's something intrinsic to, I don't know what it is. You might have further insight than me to that sound, the rhythms, maybe it's the duality of the motion. I'm not sure what it is. It could be the strings. It could be the wood. What is it about that guitar that makes you immediately feel, you know, you feel like you're on a porch or outdoors, whatever it might be.
I don't know. I agree with you. My friend Sam Dillon, who taught me how to finger pick. It's funny. That's when he showed me this, he goes, okay, I'm going to show you a thing that's like, he said, this is the answer. He's like, do you ever wonder like why all these old dudes can sit on the porch forever and ever and ever, just like endlessly playing, you know? It's like, it's this thing, you know, it's a pattern. It's one thing against another thing. It's a, how did he put it? He had a funny way of putting it. He just said, then you're really playing. And it's really true. You know what I mean? It is, but you are. It's like, so it seems, you know, a portable stringed instrument is like one of the first things that any human being endeavored to do, you know? Sure. So we're definitely hardwired to respond to that sound, you know? And a guitar is the cheapest piano you could get. You know what I mean? Like, if you're going to pick, you know, like you're going to be a picker, it's the smallest, most self-contained thing. But that's also like why I was really fascinated by it, especially when going to these bluegrass things. Like, for example, like you grow up and people go, oh, you mean like hillbilly shit? Like, oh, huh. Like when a banjo starts playing and people kind of laugh at it and go, oh, it's like, dude, you're the sucker. You're the one who's going like this, looking like an idiot. You know what I mean? Like, you can't even help it, you know? And I really was fascinated. Like, what is it that gets people's heads nodding? What is that? Why is that? And it really is. There's something about playing a finger picking pattern on guitar that hypnotizes people. It does. You know what I mean?
It's like a portal. It's like a sonic portal where it's like,
it really is. Yeah.
Like immediate. It's like, you don't have to speak the same language verbally, but you immediately understand something. Let me have a rule and a saw and a board and I'll cut it. Climb up a ladder with a hammer and a nail and I'll nail it. Well, we worked so hard to build a little house together. In the snow or the rain or the ice cold wind, whenever. No matter any weather, we're together.
It's incredible. Yeah. And I swear, and all I can say is that there's just such a huge difference between striking a guitar, just like with one meaty fist and hitting all the, and having these two separate things going on. There's a world of difference, you know, and the portal opens up when you start picking. It just does, you know, and it's really neat. And the thing to remember is like, you can fucking do it. You just sit there and do it. And it takes forever, you know, but like once you get one pattern down really slow, it's just like piano, you know what I mean? It's like, okay, right. You know, because everything that I do is based off of one pattern. Oh, you know who's cool? Actually, I made a note just to say, there's a woman named Shannon Wright, Wright.
Okay.
She's so goddamn great. And she's a perfect, I was talking to somebody else about just an example of like what's rad about finger picking. Check out a song called Little Black Stray by Shannon Wright. And if you just want to see, like, I mean, there's like a universe in that song and it's so dope. And that's like, that's, I think, just one guitar and drums and vocal. And it sounds like it's live and it's so damn cool. And like, this is like, you'll see what I mean. It's rocking as hell. It's really rocking and really scary and really beautiful. And all these things that like, it just shows the potential for like where a rocking sound can go if you take away a pick and you start thinking more compositionally on electric guitar, but it's still not like progressive rock or anything like that. It's still very feel oriented, you know.
And when you do pick up an electric guitar, do you have entirely different, like, is it like a different instinct mode kicks in?
I mean, not really. That's the thing, is that in fact, like, my trick is basically playing electric guitar like an acoustic, like the trick that I mean, a million other people have done it too, and this is like what that Shannon Wright song is doing, which is like, no, not really. In fact, if you kind of see the electric guitar, like, you turn up the amp really loud and realize that and you're that you are controlling the dynamic with your fingers, you know, and you're striking, or you could go tons of places with the electric guitar, treating it like an acoustic guitar. So as opposed to, like, certainly, yeah, or I could pick up a guitar and just go to the rock electric guitar mode, you know, which I think is like not really terribly exciting at this point, you know, like, and I totally get it. Like, but I mean, like, just being able to do, like, to hit a John Mayer sounding fucking thing or something like that, it's like, I guess if that's what you want to do, you know, but like, as far as just doing like licks on electric guitar, that's all totally, that's a headspace for sure. But it's definitely one that I kind of made a point of getting away from a long time ago. And I'd sort of rather like let the guitar make a horrible noise than play like that, than nail a Van Halen run. As my, you know, but I would also rather listen to Van Halen, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. I'd rather listen to it. I know I could probably get there, but that just, I just feel like it's been so covered that I can't, it doesn't even read as music anymore when I hear somebody trying to copy, like, to do guitar center licks. But that's a personal thing, you know, like, you know, also, like, I think that's a great way to go if you're learning how to play something. And if you're just going for something, you may as well just go for whatever's the brightest and flashiest thing, you know, when you're first learning, you know.
Sure. Yeah. And in finding your sound, that's something that you're finding your voice. What are your thoughts on that? Because that's something that you hear a lot. You hear a lot. Everybody kind of knows what it means, but I want your take.
You know, it's just, it's funny. I was just this morning, my bandmate from Chavez sent me music that his son, who's 17, is doing, and he's so good. He's so, like, and this kid is so much better than I was at 17. It's embarrassing. But you know, it's funny, I thought about that finding your voice thing and stuff, and you know, finding your voice, it's just playing for a really long time. And it's so funny, it's, you get there, you know. I mean, I think I can't think of anybody who, with their own authentic voice, who didn't sound exactly like their heroes when they first started. So that's fine, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, it's totally, totally fine. I mean, I think that to find your own voice, you should copy whatever you love, but like really copy it, like because they're like, I feel like some people are drawn. When you're starting music, you're sometimes drawn to things that you love because it sounds kind of easy. Like, people like fucking Nirvana because Cobain, you know, and that, oh, I think I could do that, you know, and that feels good, you know. It's like, right, well, that's the easiest part. And maybe you're identifying, I think that one should be careful to see whether they're identifying with the easiest part of them, of music, the most quote unquote cathartic part of music, because it's the easiest part. You know what I mean? Is that why you're identifying with it? And then you want to kind of just move a little bit past that. So for example, like, stick with Nirvana, you know, like, if you want to learn Smells Like Teen Spirit, I guess, you know, that psycho wrote it in F. For some reason, that song's in F. That's a real pain in the ass, you know, to play. But you know what? Learn it that way. Learn it the really hard way. Learn it so you have it, like, if you want to copy it, like, not the easy, don't copy because it's easy for you to copy, like, really copy it exact, you know, like, figure out, like, slow it down so you are just marrying it completely. And in that process, you're going to learn a lot, you know what I mean? And by the time that you're out the other end and able to sound exactly like this thing, you're going to start to really know what your voice is, because it's not the thing that, you know what I mean? Like, it's just that. I think that you really can find your own voice by learning how to copy shit to the letter, to the nanosecond. And in that process, you get better. You learn what other people's voices are. And in that, you kind of come to your own thing. I that's all I can say, because it's really tricky. It's like, I can't, like, I just did a guitar solo that I was like, wow, this is kind of the culmination of everything that I've ever tried to do with a guitar solo. And the response was, oh, is that you playing guitar? That's what a lot of people said, you know? Like, some people were like, oh, that's so cool. You know, I was like, wow, that's weird. You know, and then a couple of other people were like, wow, dude, it's so cool. I could always tell that it's you playing guitar. You know, so it's like, yeah. I don't fucking know. And in some ways I was like, well, that's great, because that means that I must be doing something right. Because sure. It means that some people don't recognize it. Some people think that it's exactly what I am. All I know is that it means that I'm moving forward or something. That's what I'd say about finding your own voice. It's also like, self-expression is so fucking overrated. It's so overrated, you know? And it's like, in music, it's like your purest form of self-expression is when you suck and you're 15 years old and you go, that's self-expression, you know? Everything mm-hmm. beyond that, like, just please get that out of the way. And like, learn how to express human feelings, not your own, just the feelings that we all have. And the way to learn how to express human feelings is to learn that Joni Mitchell song that you're obsessed with, just really, really, really learning it. You know, that's a way to connect to a bigger feeling, for example, you know what I mean? And this is staying on the subject of finding your own voice, because, you know, like, you know, and that's what I mean, like my own voice is, I guess, like a scared person, a scared sniveling child covered in shit screaming, you know. I guess that's my authentic voice. I think that's everybody's authentic voice, you know. It's like, but like, you know what I mean? Other than that, it takes a lot of discipline to find your voice. It takes a lot of shutting the fuck up to find your own voice, you know. It takes a lot of like listening and learning.
You said something very interesting. I've not heard that before. That basically a dichotomy between self-expression and human emotion, let's say.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
So you know, where do they divert? Because you're saying that self-expression is overrated. That's a mm-hmm. I like that a lot. Yeah, I can run with that. But at the same time, like if someone is expressing themselves, how are they not expressing human emotion?
Well, okay. I mean, and it's tricky. And I'm sure we're not going to get all the way there. But what I mean is, so for example, if I'm, let's take it to the Red Dead Redemption. So mm-hmm. I'm watching this thing that I have to come up with a theme for, this scene, right? And mm-hmm. say, I feel really strongly, you know, my feeling is that, you know, that this woman should have a very pretty theme for her thing, you know, but mm-hmm. like, and I really, really think that it's like, no, well, that's the beginning of self-expression being a problem. You know, it's like, mm-hmm. maybe I should connect to what, let's say we're keeping on the game, what the theme of the scene is. Maybe I should ask a few more questions as to why this character is doing this thing, or why is this character actually upset, or is she, you know, I don't know, is she pretending to be upset? I don't know. But again, taking myself out and then finding what the emotion is that I'm supposed to be hitting, that's mm-hmm. not my emotion. That's mm-hmm. an emotion that I could remember, you know, maybe, you know, like maybe that happened to me, you know, like say I'm supposed to play, so I'm supposed to make something angry for this theme or whatever, I don't know, for this woman that I'm watching on the screen, for this video game character that I'm watching on the screen. I have to make up something that's not how I'm feeling, but I could draw on the feeling that I've had before, put it mm-hmm. with this situation now, and that's not expressing myself, that is expressing an emotion, you know what I mean? So it's being aware of what your feelings are, but knowing that other people have other feelings and finding the thing to connect, you know. I'm trying to give like another.
You know what? I'd love to use it as an example. I think it's
sure.
illustrated the point perfectly, but since we brushed mm-hmm. across it, and it's such a transformative mm-hmm. album, and for in my own personal musical background, that Johnny Cash album, I mean, Jesus fucking Christ.
So the records that I played on are 5 and 6. So that's like God's Gonna Cut You Down and all that.
Yeah.
And Okay, this is a good example. Actually, this was a rare example of me being sort of smart. So I had no idea what, all I knew was what I had said was, which was, I had been told that by Rick Rubin's people that there is like dozens of songs that were that Mr. Cash had recorded when he was sick, and they were meant to be finished with a live band, you know, now. So that what that meant to me was
that's that pressure, man. That's a lot of pressure.
Yeah, no fucking shit, dude. Yeah. But what that meant to me was like it had nothing to do with me. It was like, okay, it's going to be up to me to serve this song. And that sounds like some sort of, well, actually, yeah, it really was. It was for me to fucking serve this song. It's a goddamn Johnny Cash song. So, and what that meant was like, what am I going to bring to serve this? Am I, you know, like what the fuck do you do? Like I had no idea what to do. So I was like, okay, I know people who've recorded with Rick, and I know what the studio is, and I've seen pictures, and I know that there's fucking tons of guitars there. So I'm not going to bring anything. That was my first thought. You know, it was like, this is, we're talking about self-expression. I was like, well, I think that I'm going to do whatever I can do to make this situation good, which is Johnny Cash's situation. That's we're recording where he recorded all these records. I know there's a bunch of guitars. So like, I'm going to just show up and see what is needed, you know, like, because I know there isn't anything that I could bring of my own toolkit. Like that'd be fucking ridiculous, you know, in my opinion. That's just me. And sure enough, it turned out to be a good thing, because I was like, all right, great. There's all this great gear. I could like, you know, and there's better gear than I fucking have, you know, like, so these are much nicer guitars. And then I asked Rick, cause I was terrified, you know, like I kind of like over in the corner the first time, like we're listening. So it's just Johnny Cash's voice to a click, you know? And it's fucking Tom Petty's band is sitting there listening and taking notes. I don't know how to take notes, you know. Like I have since learned some of those things, but like I didn't, you know. And so I just said to Rick, I was like, what the fuck am I supposed to do? I was like, what if I like, should I try to come up with like parts? He goes, yeah. I was like, but what if the part isn't right? He goes, you're isolated. We could just hit erase. So that was the big moment for me. I was like, somehow that was like a total positive, you know, like where I was like, oh, cool. That's right. He fucking asked me to, you know, I have no idea what I'm doing. These guys know what they're doing. I'm going to be in my corner. You know, I'm going to be sitting there playing live, but I'm isolated. I guess I should, you know, he asked me to do this, you know, like he asked me to play and use whatever it is that I think is going to be right for the song. You know what I mean? Like, and so I had to be confident that my feeling for what was needed was going to be the right one. You know what I mean? It was nice to know that I wasn't going to fucking step on anything, because it would just be wiped out, you know? And
you had creative freedom.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. And then of course it also makes you be like, right, well, I certainly want to do whatever it is that the song needs. And maybe it doesn't need anything. Like Fergie had a great line. And I think Fergie was like, yeah, man, you know how to lay out, you know, like I was like, yeah, laying out. And Fergie goes, man, I've laid out on some of the best records you've ever heard. but I really believe that, like, if you don't know what to play, just don't play anything. How about that? You know, and then also somebody else had told me this when I was younger, which is like, it was a singer who's like, dude, don't play a lick when I'm singing. You know, like he's like, just like, it's really simple, you know, it's kind of stuff. But it was like, I kind of, by the time that I got to, I was lucky enough to be in this room doing this Johnny Cash stuff, I had learned like, just because I've been playing with Will, I was like, people are coming to hear this guy sing, you know, mm-hmm. like, mm-hmm. but you got to frame it and don't play when he's singing. And if he sings something good, then play something simple that's a reaction to that. You know what I mean? Like, and it doesn't have to be, you're answering, you know, like I really believe that call and response is a really good thing to keep in mind. Like as a player and stuff. And when you're playing with other people, there's just a million ways to do call and response. You know what I mean? It's just you don't have to say back what they said, but you just answer, you know, or, you know, reflect maybe, you know, like, and again, I don't play a million notes. It's like, usually my answer is a reflection. It's just like, I'll just play like a fucking note or a chord or something, you know.
Yeah, but that's, I caught that on your playing, you know, listening to your stuff. You remind me actually of my favorite drummer. You probably never heard of him. His name is Dion Newble, but he's played with Lauryn Hill and Snoop and everybody. But like, he's just a pocket drummer, and he does the same thing. He just cuts out. He doesn't do many flashy fills or anything. He just stops.
You just want to make, it's, I mean, cause like, you know, singing's like number one, you know, like everybody, singing is like the chief instrument in the world. It's like, it's the human voice. And then like, you know, dumb shit like a guitar or a piano or something like that. Then number two is like the thing that goes with the other thing. You know what I mean? Or when it's really good, can take the place of the other thing, or, you know, maybe, you know, but like it is, I should give credit. Also, my grandmother had a huge impact on the way that I listen to music, because she worked for David O. Selznick. She was in the, among other things, she was David O. Selznick's secretary. That's the guy who produced Gone with the Wind. He's a famous, very, very famous, gnarly Hollywood producer who was known for, he was a speed freak, and he just did memos all day. And my grandmother's job was to write these memos, but she was, you know, in the business and liked movies a lot. And I grew up, it was always about the accompanist. It was always about the music, and it was always about the accompanist. My grandmother would always say, listen to this accompanist. It was always an accompanist, always, you know, it was always about that. And she would always say how important that was, and how, and really it made it, you know, by the time that I was, you know, 10, I knew what an accompanist was, you know, and I knew the idea. And I did have some idea of, I guess restraint isn't the word, but I was aware of the fact that somebody who was not in the foreground was making the foreground really awesome. You know what I mean? And then, and again, it was nothing that I aspired to. It was nothing that I thought was, you know, it was just something that was there. And it was just some knowledge that I knew was, you know, was that. And because I would definitely aspire to like the Butthole Surfers when I was 13 or 14. Yeah. That idea of playing with somebody else and laying back and giving the voice room, you know, it's huge, you know, and so many great play, you know, you can have a really great career in music if without being like any kind of technical genius, if you can vibe with a singer and sure. just make the singer, you know, it's like, and it's pretty fucking cool, you know, like,
yeah.
And again, like I do loads of different things, but like, I love great singers, and like, I can't believe that I've gotten to be around these, you know, I've gotten to hear these voices in a room and stuff. And that's largely because I just didn't play much, you know. It's like
Adele being one of them.
Yeah, I mean, totally. I was actually thinking about that. I was thinking of her when I was saying that. You know, she's cool shit. And again, you know, that's somebody. You know, I haven't seen her in 10 years, but when we made that record, I didn't know who she was. She didn't know who I was. Certainly, you know, I was like the guy that Rick hired. She had one record out. I didn't know anything about her. I knew nothing about her, you know, but we clicked right away because she was super into music. She was super into listening to music. She was, you know, we were we weirdly both like 70s Dion, you know what I mean? And like, and that there's a 21-year-old kid who was like in the 70s Dion. Yeah. Sure. And in fact, Adele told me back then, I remember she was like, she had said like, her plan was like to be a music publicist. I think she told me back then. Yeah. Really? Like she was, yeah, she was just like, she went to some high school that like lots of, it's kind of a performing artsy high school thing, but she was like, she was a fan. She was into music. You know, she knew she was going to be around music, but she had no like diva, whatever, you know, like it was just like, she had this, she could listen, you know? And so we would talk about songs. She wouldn't talk about how she was fucking feeling, you know, or and in fact, when we were talking about self-expression, this is one of the greatest singers in the world, you know, it's like, yeah, you do that, but she had a sense of humor about it too, you know, like, I don't know how to put it, but she was just a fucking joy to hang out with, you know, and could just one of the best singers ever, but it was like, the idea was about connecting. It was about making a really great song. It wasn't like, I need to sing this thing because I need to get this thing out of, you know, it's like, you want to make something for other people to feel like that. That's the real beauty, you know, because, you know, and again, like self-expression is rad, but to me, self-expression is like, is gnarly and nasty and gross. You know, not, I think, I don't know, you know, you want to express human expression is what you're going for more than self-expression, I think, ideally.
Do you, when you are in a room with Adele or working on a Johnny Cash record, do you feel, you know, we talked about the pressure of that. Do you feel like your job, you know, you want to serve the song. Do you feel like you are there for a reason? Do you have a sort of spiritual or any, like you were placed there at that moment in time and you are there for a reason? You were selected.
I just always feel like I'm really, 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 really lucky, super, super lucky. Like beyond that I get to do this and that I've gotten into these rooms was like so much to do with luck and timing, but you do make your own luck and you make your own timing, you know? And so yeah, you know, it's funny that you said that because there have been, it is a way, I think I've thought that when I was really nervous, you know, it's the same, you know, which is just like, Jesus Christ, you know, like the imposter syndrome kicks in.
Yeah.
And then you just gotta be like, yeah, there is a reason that I'm here. And yeah, you know, like music's really important to me and the song's gotta be great. And my presence is affecting it in some way. And I want it to affect it in a way where the singer is just gonna kick it up that much more or pull it back that much more or whatever it is, you know? And so yeah, I've definitely had that feeling like, wow, it's like, I'm here for a reason, you know? But the reason literally, it's pretty simple. It's just, you know, it's almost like it's good. Ideally, you could apply that sort of thinking to almost anything you do, you know, like, but yeah, it's.
You can to push back a little bit. The reason I, mm-hmm. Any question, the reason I ask that is because these are records. We don't even have to call them records. These are experiences that will be experienced mm-hmm. by millions of people for just time beyond, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's
mm-hmm.
just like another song. Not to say that there's better songs or worse songs, but this is sure. these are sure. things that will affect not only the current zeitgeist, but like generations to come. And you were the guy playing the guitar. You know what
yeah,
I'm saying?
I kind of, yeah, it's sort of, I've thought about it this way on, well, you know, well, okay. I've thought about it this way. It's like, you know, it's more, I see my role in these that I've been in, I've been lucky enough to be around these or in on these recordings or have contributed to these recordings. It's like being a part of a built working on a building. You know what I mean? It's like I got to design the gargoyle or like I did that gargoyle over there. Yeah. Or I did the watch, you know, the face of the watchtower is mine or like, you know, I designed the windows or whatever you want to say. Like that's, and I used to wonder about that when I was a little kid, maybe everybody does, you know, it's like, well, yeah, obviously a lot of people took a lot, you know, when you realize that one person could not have made that building and you're enjoying that building and you get this sense like mom, dad, are the people who made that building alive anymore? You heard that question, you know, and they're like, no, they're not. You know, you can't. It's like, I definitely feel that way about songs, which is like, nobody knows on these big, big songs that you're talking about that are going to, you know, resonate forever and are going to be reflected on millions of people. You know, they don't give a fuck about me or anything like that. They don't care that I play guitar. They don't, you know. But just in the same way that millions of people who are looking at a beautiful building, they don't care who designed the windows or anything like that. But they fucking certainly appreciate the windows. And those windows are going to fucking be there forever. And they're going to be improving. People are going to be thinking that they're lovely forever and aspiring to want to go up in that window or whatever the fuck. You know. And in that regard, it does feel really good. It feels like you're doing anonymous work for people where you're getting paid for it, you know, and these songs, you know, because so many of my favorite songs are just my favorite songs. Or, you know, or it's like, you know, it's like what Bill Withers said about like his career. He's like, my songs were like a change in everybody's pockets. You know, like everybody's got them. They might not know that it's me, but they definitely know that song. You know, and they could use it, and it's there for them. They could go, I know. and they might not even know who the, you know, I remember actually, I was on a big Bill Withers kick, just obsessing on him. I was like, Mom, do you know who Bill Withers is? She's like, no. I was like, he wrote that song, Grandma's Hands. And she goes, And I go, you know, and she goes, oh, right. I know. So that was really funny. But it's that, you know, like, well, I don't know what that is, but that is maybe some kind of calling, or it does feel good to know that, like, you know, that something that I did that was difficult to do that helped this song, make the song what it is, even if it's just, I'm just the guitar player or something like that. But it's like, that's a cool feeling. It's a cool feeling to know that, you know, that people are going to be hearing stuff that I did. Anonymous stuff that I did. I swear to God, actually, I totally have a fetish for this. I always thought of it as kind of like, and this is different than like songs that I've written. That's a different kind of ego thing. But as far as like an egoless, it's almost like doing graffiti. It's like getting away with like getting to have a tag, but like it's like the subtlest tag ever. Because like if you really tag it right, nobody ever even sees the tag. You know what I mean? Like. In the case of working on a song, you know, like it's or being hired to play guitar on somebody's song, it's like I'd really just have the song be great, and like, you know, and if I laid out on the song, that's not even better. I don't care, you know, so yeah, you know, it's trippy, it's a trippy feeling, but it's like a kind of a humble public servant feeling.
That's good. Like that. I mean, I think that's a great way to look at it. Do you have any dream projects or people you'd like to work with that you have not yet? Or is there anything that anything that you'd like to accomplish?
Yeah. I'd love to. I don't know if it'll ever happen. So, and it's nothing to shoot for, but I would be interested in having a song that was like, you know, that was known by people who like have like a poppy song, you know, that just existed and had a life of its own that has nothing to do with me. I've just never really fucked with the pop world that much or had like a hit pop song. I'm not going to go out and try to write one, you know, but that just seems to be sort of like what you're talking about. That would be kind of a neat feeling, you know, and I've had versions of that where I've co-written on like almost anonymously co-written on some pop songs. It was like, oh, that's kind of funny. John Legend said a word that I, or said a sentence that I wrote, you know, nobody's ever going to know. But like, yeah, so I think I'd like to have, I guess maybe having like a song that everybody knows that I wrote would be kind of cool. I think that would be neat. And I've come, you know, yeah.
Oh, no, go ahead, please.
I was going to say, you know, yeah, I guess that's it. I've done things like that, you know, and like we've sort of touched on the fact that like I like that music that I've made is stuff that people know, but I wouldn't mind if it was like a, you know, I love that song, Louie Louie, you know. and I could be like, oh, I wrote that song, Louie Louie, too. You know, that would be, I'm trying to think, there's some dudes that I really like, you know, like John Prine wrote, he didn't have any hit songs except for You Never Really Called Me By My Name, which is like a huge, huge song, which I think he wrote, but also took his name off, but he still got credit. You know what I mean? I always thought that was the illest, you know, like something like that would be the fucking coolest. Is like, yeah, I wrote, you know, that fucking annoying song that everybody knows or that's funny song that everybody knows. I also wrote that. You didn't even know I wrote that, but I wrote
Angel from Montgomery.
Well, that's what I'm saying. But like, that's not like a hit. That's like a beloved. That's what I'm saying. Is like Prime was like the god in so many levels, but in that regard, where it's like he had a mailbox money song that allowed him to be super free to do whatever the fuck he wants, you know, and like, and somebody I brought up Will Oldham a lot, but somebody like Will, all he's done is, I mean, he's written thousands of incredible songs, and sometimes I think that for Will too, because like Will wrote I See a Darkness, which is like one of my favorite Johnny Cash recordings, you know, and actually he wrote John Legend whatever his last, the album before the last one, he wrote the title track. But still, nobody really knows who Will is, you know, and sometimes, but in a good way, you know. And yeah. Sometimes I get jealous of Will. It's like, wow, this guy gets to write mainstream songs and still doesn't have to deal with any bullshit. Nobody's bothering him. It's so sick, you know, that's so cool. But then sometimes I also feel like, well, damn it, you know, Will should be known as like a should have like huge hit songs, you know. But then sometimes I wonder, maybe the kind of songs that somebody like a song like I See a Darkness, that's one of the best songs ever written. That's not a popular notion, you know what I mean? That's not a song that's meant, you know, that's like an Angel of Montgomery kind of song, you know what I mean? It's like that, that's touching on things that are too personal maybe for the mainstream to you know. But yeah, I guess that's something that I like.
It's like human connection. Both of those songs, man, are very much like, you know, when just using Angel from Montgomery as an example, like when you hear Bonnie Raitt, you know, and I am an old woman, like flies buzzing in the kitchen, all that. Like, I'm not an old woman and there are no flies buzzing in the kitchen, but I know how that feels. I feel you.
I know how that feels. Totally. But then also like, and then Prine's original version, it's John Prine saying, I am an old woman. I love that kind of stuff. I love that kind of stuff so much. You know what I mean? Like when there's this like magic that happens when something is so, it's John Prine saying, I am an old woman is not the greatest example, but it's sort of what I'm saying is like when something is so fucking particular, it's so particular and so unto itself that it becomes universal, you know, and that's the best thing. And that happens all over the place in all sorts of ways, you know, like there's way, like, you know, I don't know, Prince. Who's like Prince? Nobody's like Prince.
Sorry to cut you off. I was literally about to say Prince. I was being a kind interviewee and not saying Prince.
Amazing. Yeah, you know? And it's interesting because I was thinking, and then also on another level, and also just sort of keeping myself humble and also just always to remind myself, I don't know what the fuck anybody wants. It's like, Michael Jackson is somebody who also is that way. I have never understood Michael Jackson ever, you know, I never related to it, never spoke to me in any way. I never understood him, never understood his music. I never understood a lyric that he's singing about. I don't understand anything, but nonetheless, this is a good example of certainly somebody who is like nobody else and is a very strange person. And yet the entire world, you know, feels, you know, and that's cool. You know, like
totally.
That's a really cool thing to remind. It's like, and I think Thelonious Monk said, there's a great, if you ever look up Monk's rules, have you ever seen it? It's so fucking cool. It's I think somebody who played with him would just write things down when Monk would say, always remember this. And so there's this handwritten thing that a musician wrote down of Monk's rules. And one of his things is, genius is that which is most like itself, is one of his lines.
That's heavy. Yeah. I'm going to have to wrap my head around that one. That's going to take
Look up Monk's rules. All of them are great. They're all really cool. They're like, some of them are kind of mysterious. Some of them are so fucking straightforward. You're like, God, I can't believe I never. Yes. That's really smart. You know, like,
I literally gonna get up and look that up. That's awesome.
Look it up. Monk's rules. Yeah.
I'm conscious of the time, so I'm going to ask you some rapid fire questions.
Of course.
This is a kind of a mean question, but answer it however you want. Top three favorite musicians or artists? However you want to answer that.
Yeah. I guess, you know, since it changes all the time, let me see. Ibrahim from Tanarawin, the guy who started the band Tanarawin, because that's a guy who saw his father get murdered in front of, you know, in front of him, and then chose to make music, and it was also forced to kill people and do all this horrible shit just to live, just to not starve, and then took a guitar and made beautiful, beautiful, beautiful music, which is constantly asking the question, why would anybody hurt anybody else? So the band is called Tinariwen, T-I-N-A-W-I-R-E-N. They're an African psychedelic rock band, I guess. I don't know how to describe it, but I'd say he's probably one of the coolest people who, to ever do music, and he's definitely a hero of mine. You know, Merle Haggard's an easy person to say is a hero of mine because the guy never made a bad record, and just, there's so many hundreds of incredible songs and incredible singing. And, you know, let's say, you know, I'm going to say Prince, because that's just, he's just so great and he's easy to access for everybody. Yeah, let's just say those, we can say those three.
It's perfect. Perfect. You touched upon this a little bit already, but if you could give one piece of advice to upcoming musicians, what would it be?
I want to say practice, and it's such a lame thing to say.
Oh, it's good.
Like, just sit in your sweatpants. Like, just don't be afraid to just suck so hard. Like, really suck. Like, just be by yourself and like learn. Just sound terrible. Just by yourself and like, just keep on working at it. Just like, be patient with yourself and slow it down. If you can't get it, if you're trying to learn something, just slow it down and try. Just be patient with yourself. Don't beat yourself up too hard when you're trying to learn something, but like, keep on practicing, because people love it when you sound good, and they don't care how you got there. They do not care if you practice a million hours, you know, in fact, I'll finish with this. I was in Nashville. I saw Cat Stevens play. I play with him sometimes, and I went out with his band, who were like these unbelievable musicians, and I took him to Tootsie's to go see some live music. And there happened to be a fucking incredible band. There's always an incredible band at Tootsie's in Nashville, but this band was really good and really speaking to me. It was like a guy playing a Telecaster. They're playing like country rock, but like 70s style country rock. And the dude was so good, and I was kind of getting hammered, and I'm sitting with Cat Stevens' incredible musicians, and I was like, man, I can never play that good. I mean, that guy's just, man, he's just incredible. And I think Kwame Yeboah, who plays with Cat Stevens, who's like this one of the best musicians in the world, he goes, man, this guy just practiced a lot. He just practiced a lot. Don't be so hard on yourself, man. He just practiced a lot. That's all he did. That's all I did.
That's great.
You know, so it sounds like, it was, awesome. I was like,
he's right.
He's right. Totally right. Yeah. Because I was sitting there making this big deal about how this guy, you know, because I was like, look, he's just singing his heart out. His heart's being sung through the Telecaster in this fucking bar. And I know he's just doing it for money, but that's real. And the guy's like, he practiced a lot. Shut up.
You know? I love that.
It's true.
Okay. Yeah. Last question, mm-hmm. Which I like to ask people. Whether or not you're religious, I'm not, but it's just metaphorically or literally, you get in front of God or heaven or whomever it mm-hmm. is, or purgatory, it can be whatever you want. And they say, we want to hear one song from you. What do you play?
Row, row, row your boats. Probably.
I like it. Life is better.
It's a great. Life it's an amazing song. It's a fucking yeah. amazing song. Yeah. It's really a good song. I mean, it's like lyrically good. It's around, you know, you could get St. Peter or, you know, or whoever's fucking telling you to do it. You're like, okay.
I love that. Thank you so much, Matt, for your time. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure. Yeah. Thanks, Alan. Yeah, totally, man.